actually educate, inspire, and make you think. The future is now. Topics and music that affect your life from Universal Broadcasting Network. Tune in at ubnradio.com.
Welcome, everyone, to Dr. Judy WTF. I am your host, Walt Lusk, as well as my daughter's dad. And in studio, we have a very special guest, as usual, Dr. Judy Rosenberg. We are broadcasting live here at the Sunset Gower Studios in the heart of Hollywood. And if you want to call in, this is a call-in show, and you can get on the couch with Dr. Judy if you'd like to. And the number is area code 323-284-7826. That's 323-284-7826. And today we have a really incredible show. We're talking about pets and their owners. Dogs versus cats, and we've got a little thing about elephants. And then at the end of the show, we'll do what we normally do, and stay tuned for Shrink That Tune.
So we start our show with a bow, wow, wow, and a meow, meow, meow.
Yes, indeed.
Are you sure you're your daughter's father? Did you check the genetics on that?
Absolutely. When my youngest daughter was born, the nurse looked at my daughter and said, well, we know who the dad is. Who's the mom?
Perfect.
First, since I'm a numbers guy, I thought we'd start with statistics.
Or should I say perfect?
That was absolutely perfect.
Yes.
Do you know the number of U.S. households that own pets? It's 57 million own dogs and 45 million own cats. And what was surprising is over 14 million have fish. Hmm. You know, but do fish know they're wet? I'm still trying to figure that out. And we spend it at over $56 billion a year on food and other stuff and care and probably toys.
And they're worth every penny, I think.
You think so?
I think so.
Okay.
Yes. And so one of the reasons that we decided to do this show is because, first of all, we do love animals, Walt and
yes,
I.
Yes, we do.
And human animals included sometimes.
However, yes, and some people think I'm an animal sometimes.
Well, sometimes they do.
Yes.
And for good reason, Walt.
Is that your personal or your professional opinion?
All of the above. And so one of the reasons that I'm really excited about this show is because we have so much to learn from our animals. And I do a lot of work with my patients as a clinical psychologist with healing human disconnect, mother-infant disconnect. And one of the things that the animal kingdom has to teach us is going back to nature, going back to bonding and nurturing.
I was going to say, is that nature or nurture?
Well, both.
Yeah.
Actually.
Yeah.
Both. Because we've come so far away from our biological and our natural propensity to parent, to bond as nature would have us do so. Now we're so far away from that with cell phones and so on and disconnections of all kinds. Because one of the things that I talk about much in my clinical practice is the disconnections between human beings and how these disconnections form wounds that then cause us to go symptomatic, and then people come in and I treat the symptoms and we have to retrace. And
you treat the symptoms or the cause?
Well, they want me to treat the symptoms.
Yeah, I know they do. They want a Band-Aid.
They very much do. However, that unless we go right for the cause, the symptoms will reappear. I talk a lot about the fact that symptom management techniques in and of themselves are short-lived. And so tonight we're going to talk a lot about what animals can truly teach us about unconditional love.
It's funny you should mention that, because the first article I have here is The Power of an Animal's Unconditional Love. And you know what? That's something that I think is really important.
And other people think so too. Many others.
Yes. Yes, indeed. Sharing your life with a cat or a dog seems to definitely help your mental health. A study concluded in Australia found that feline friends may experience fewer psychiatric disturbances than those without cats. I'm sure some could be proven about dogs, but I found that 95% of people who love cats or dogs are kinder and nicer people. Though the unconditional love of our pets, we learn what loyalty is, what true acceptance is, what true companionship is. This unconditional love is a true gift, one we may not always deserve, but it's always there. The unconditional love of adults for other adults generally is a gift of the heart that is opened and offered over time is trust. Respect and character are observed and friendship develops. It is sad that it is a good start to have a pet around to understand what unconditional love really does feel like.
So this is a call-in show, and we really love call-ins and hoping to hear from you, cat lovers, dog lovers, animal lovers and haters alike,
yes,
and trainers who are in the business of training animals, and psychologists who are in the business of training human animals. Okay, so we
absolutely
welcome all calls. Particularly, I want to bring up a point that you alluded to, which is that dogs are filled with unconditional love.
Well, the joke is that dogs will give love unconditionally, and you kind of have to earn it with cats.
Yeah.
Yeah, because
right,
it says here, unconditional love from our pets comes directly through the grace of love. Because they loved us unconditionally, there is perhaps no one on earth who has imparted to us that highest form of love, that most spiritual form of love, or perhaps called from within our hearts of our beloved pets.
And looking at that from a spiritual angle, I think both are such spiritual lessons in that the dog represents unconditional love unearned, which is kind of like source energy. And that is why I think dog is God spelled backwards, because there's this immense ability for dogs to be givers.
Well, I know you're a dog lover, but you know what? I'm going to throw in quotes as we go, and most of them are about dogs. Dogs are not our whole life, but they make our lives whole.
I love that. Yeah. It's beautiful. So I think both lessons are very, very high level and spiritual, because in order to please a cat, you've got to earn their love. And there's something to be said for earned love, because love is an action verb. And so you could say, I love you, I love you, I love you to as many people as you want. But if you're not behaving in a loving way, if you're not treating people in a loving way, then do you really mean that? Or are you just saying that so that you can sound good? And in the case of a cat, the lesson is earn it, baby. Put the effort in.
Yeah, they talk about toys. You know, dogs will sit there and rip the toys to shreds, and cats will kind of take care of them and hide them. And and if your cat really likes you, you know, if it goes and finds a lizard or a bird or a rat or something, or even one of its toys, and it gives it to you,
I know,
that is like, hey, this is mine. I made it. I found it. I killed it. And now I want to give it to you. I had a Russian blue cat, and all the time he'd come in.
Gifts.
I'd open the door and little gifts, and it was like amazing. It's like, you know, this was his favorite little catnip, and you know, here it is. Sure, he could get it back, but you know, it was right there.
And yeah, I've owned cats. I now own two beautiful chocolate labradoodles that I cheated the system on, because I found two labradoodles that look like chocolate labs, because I'm so in love with chocolate labs. And I thought they were going to be non-shedders. Big mistake. They shed like crazy, especially now. These animals are like you were saying, Walt, they calm the nerves down. They actually lower the blood pressure.
Yes, they do.
And so if any of you are on medication, this is serious. If you're on medication, if you have anxiety, if you have depression, we're going to talk about this more on the show. You can name your cat or dog Prozac or Zoloft, or, you know, just some creative names for you to consider. And they do offer us the connection that oftentimes we do not get early in life. And as some of you may know, people that have been tuning into our show, years ago I developed a mind map to heal human disconnect. And if you would put that up, Walt.
And if you're just watching the show or listening to the show on podcast, actually you can catch the podcast on Stitcher, or you can catch it on iTunes. It's www.drjudywtf.com.
So the thinking behind the ability to give love is that we're well emotionally nourished during the first 3 years of life, based on attachment theory and John Bowlby and Mary Ainsworth's work. on attachment and orphans, and studying the mental health of infants who have been securely attached to and those who have not been securely attached to. There's a really big difference. And so animals, when untouched by human hands and not interfered with, naturally will do all the right things to nurture their young. They will give them all the ingredients they need to form a healthy psyche, which is the eye contact, the skin contact, the breastfeeding, the licking, the heartbeat, the warmth.
Well, selling the stuff boundaries. Sounds like a lot of stuff that I need.
Right, Walt. And so, and you shall receive. Thus, and you shall receive.
And for those of you that are new to the show, what we talk about is if you have a great relationship with your mother when you are young, then that kind of reflects your inner world, or a lousy one, vice versa. And if you have a good or bad relationship with your dad, that reflects your outer world.
Right.
And if you have a lousy relationship with both caregivers, which is what Judy calls
the double dungeon.
The double dungeon.
Meaning that there's darkness when you turn to mom, and then there's more darkness when you turn to dad, and you internalize this, and so the darkness then soaks into the fiber of your being and affects your core belief about life and so on. Now, in the case of animals, they're getting all this good stuff. They're getting their emotional needs met, which I call the narcissistic supplies, and so they have a lot to give. And
yes,
so they're
do.
Natural born nurturers, because they can give what they have received, and it flows in the direction of their youth. Whereas with human animals, it doesn't always flow that way. Sometimes we get mothers who are highly self-involved, narcissistic mothers is what we might call them. Mothers who are emotionally cut off, mothers who didn't receive all of the emotional ingredients in their first few years of life, so they don't have this give, and so therefore their infants are wounded. And so this series that we create every Thursday at 8 p.m. is called The Hole in the Soul Series, and it's named Dr. Judy WTF after Freud, with the Freud, because what happens...
What? It's not Walt the Fun?
That too, okay. Walt. I'm thinking maybe that.
I mean, a couple more quotes. Dogs are miracles with paws.
I love that.
Here's one. There is
Agreed.
No psychiatrist in the world like a puppy licking your face.
Mm-hmm. Now, don't tell the pharmaceutical company that.
No,
okay?
Of course
pretty,
not.
Because pretty soon they're going to be selling little bottles of doggies and kitties and, you know.
This was an interesting quote from Gilda Radner. I think dogs are the most amazing creatures. They give unconditional love. For me, they are the role model for being alive.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Wow. And she went through some very radical cancer.
Yes, she had
ovarian
cancer.
Treatment.
And I don't think her husband, who was Gene Wilder, was ever the same when she passed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So think about it. When someone is losing their outer shell and they're dying, they're going through a metamorphosis with their own personal being. And we live in a society where we're so judged on the way we look. And so there's just such a fear of not being accepted if we get too fat, too thin, too sick, too ugly, too whatever.
Yeah, well,
but
again, if your dog is fat, mm-hmm. you aren't walking them enough.
Probably. Right.
No, if you are fat, you're not walking your dog enough. That was it.
Yeah, and so if you want to get thinner and you want your dog to get thinner, then like a little furry exercise
mm-hmm.
program right
mm-hmm.
there.
Absolutely.
So a dog or a cat or any animal doesn't care what you look like.
Mm-mm.
They care how you are, the being of you.
Mm-hmm.
And so the being is really what is the connection between two human beings, because that's why we're called human beings. We're not called human doings, although we do tend to love what we do and we love what we do for each other. Ultimately, we are human beings. And one thing that I definitely learned from my dogs is that no matter what I do all day, and sometimes my days are really, really long, and I, like everybody out there, can build up stress. And now I'm doing yoga. Thank you, Core Power Yoga. I just
Absolutely.
Want to say it again.
Yeah, Core Power Yoga.
Denise, if you're listening, my instructor, who was on here.
She's a guest. She was a call-in a few weeks ago.
Hope she comes back.
Mm-hmm.
We all need to de-stress, and animals are natural. They change our biochemistry, literally, because the minute we touch them, we can calm down.
One of the things I'm going to hopefully get to is like petting a cat, right? Mm-hmm. It really calms you down.
Yes.
And there's nothing like petting a cat and listening to it purr. Right?
Just the sound of the purr, mm-hmm. right?
Yep.
And synchronizing your breathing to the dog. So my dogs mm-hmm. are just such a joy for me to be around. And in my private practice, I actually work out of my home. And I have my dogs around for people who don't mind them being around. And most people just are in love with my dogs. And part of the joy of coming to my private practice is seeing Sophie and Simon.
Yeah, they're the mascots of the practice.
They very much are. And it's just so interesting. I want to share a couple of dog patient stories here. Hysterical. I do a lot of work with going into the wounds of the first 3 years of life and, if you will, going into that mental, emotional space with people so that they can express the repress.
Okay.
And heal the wounds.
Right.
And move the process forward so that they're not emotionally stuck in that space. And of course, one of what I have to deal with is oftentimes resistance, natural course of therapy, resistance. So what happens is that my dogs intuitively know when I'm going there with people, and they will oftentimes get on the couch. Speaking of getting on the couch, I'll have Sophie flanking the person that I'm working with on the left and Simon on the right, and it's almost like they're intuitively knowing that this person is in a state of upset, emotional upset. And so I'll laugh with my patients about this because I'll say, whoa, 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 no doggy defense mechanisms allowed. Okay, Sophie, Simon, you can be in the room, but, you know, we're working through this thing. How beautifully intuitive they are.
They are.
How empathic they are when people are going through some real crises and emotional pain. They will actually say, please don't take the dogs out of the room. We want the dogs here. And so in a true sense, they're my therapeutic dogs.
Ah.
Kind of
like a seeing eye dog, huh?
Sort of like that, yes. And so please do call in. I know there are a lot of pet owners out there, and I know that there are a lot of listeners out there listening. So
just remember,
if you're talking too much, it's because you're not talking to us. So call us and get on the couch with Walt and I. We're both on the couch
we
now.
Are. And remember, the reason why a dog has so many friends is that he wags his tail instead of his tongue.
Mm.
The number is 323-284-7826, 323-284-7826. So we can have a dog story or a cat story. Here's some personality differences. I wanted to address this between dog and owners and cat owners. You know, that, I mean, there are dog people and cat people, and it turns out there have been studies all over the world. England is one of the primary ones about comparing the two. And apparently cats appear to be much easier to hate than dogs.
Mm-hmm.
But canines are usually a social animal, and they're usually in packs. So dogs will intrude on a person's ongoing activities if they are feeling lonely and want some company and play. Cats, on their hand, well, they're just awfully visible during the day. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But it turns out that dog owners are generally more extroverted and more agreeable, while in addition, dog people are more conscientious than cat people. But conscious involves a tendency to show self-discipline to complete a task and aim for advancement and achievement.
You mean like a dog's personality?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So, but cat people generally are more neurotic. However, they are also more open than dog people. For example, they have a higher appreciation of art, emotion, adventure, unusual ideas, imagination, curiosity, and a variety of experiences.
Mm-hmm.
People have high on openness are more likely to hold unconventional beliefs, while people with low scores on openness, like dog people, tend to be more conventional and traditional interests.
Interesting.
So this was really, really interesting in terms of the similarities. And then they talk a lot about the fact that maybe a lot reason why a lot of people have cats is they live in urban areas. They mm-hmm. work long hours.
Makes
thereby, they have a
sense.
higher job. They make more money. They're more educated.
Mm-hmm.
And so from that perspective, that kind of falls into play.
Mm-hmm.
but cat owners are relatively low in dominance. People who are high on dominance are generally described as being forceful, assertive, persistent, self-assured, and self-confident. They are people who stand out in social gatherings as opposed to people who are low in dominance. They come across as being timid, bashful, shy, or unassertive.
Can't order a cat around, can you?
No, you cannot order a cat around. You ever tried to take a cat for a walk with a leash?
Yeah.
Final determination they looked at was trust. And cat owners appear to be fairly trusting. Okay.
Cat owners tend to be fairly trusting. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, very interesting. I like the first comment about cats are easier to hate.
Yeah.
And I remember one of my supervisors when I was studying to be a psychologist said that we all need to be married because we all need somebody to hate. So for those of you who aren't married and you need somebody to hate, I guess it's the cat, right?
But then the joke is you come home and have a big bad day and you kick the dog,
yes.
Right? So
yeah.
I guess it can go both ways.
And I want to talk about that more in depth because sometimes unhealthy people will project their anger not only on other human beings, but they'll project their anger on animals. And we could see this early on in children, and a very, very, very bad sign of pathology in children is the lack of empathy toward animals.
Right. They talked
about
that.
And the herding of animals. And I've actually watched this with children. I've watched children whose parents are particularly aggressive, children who've watched their parents create domestically violent scenarios, who've lived through this, which is another form of emotional abuse. And these children do not know what to do with their aggression. So they will pick the least or the most weak person, or in this case, animal in the family, and they will express their anger on this weakest link,
yes.
Oftentimes the dog.
Mm-hmm.
So for those of you out there who are parents, caretakers, school teachers, babysitters, if you notice that a child is exhibiting signs of aggression toward the animal, take it very, very seriously.
Absolutely.
These are early signs of sociopathy, and the child needs a lot of healing, and they need to heal all of the traumas and wounds of their first phase of life so that they don't need to unload and explode on an animal or any creature.
And if you're feeling like you want to unload, or if you feel like you want to explode or implode, don't do that. Just unload by calling Dr. Judy. Give us a shout, 323-284-7826. Dogs are miracles with paws, and my little dog is a heartbeat with feet. I thought that was kind of cute. You want a job, Judy? Yeah, I know you have one, but scratch a dog.
Sure, another job.
Scratch a dog, and you find a permanent job. Now, let's see. I thought we'd have some fun with some stuff. It's top 10 reasons why cats are better than dogs. Because I'm more of a, I'll admit it, Judy's a dog person. I'm a cat person.
You know, I'm mostly a dog person, but I love cats. I think I just love all animals.
Mm-hmm.
And dogs, for what I'm so much of a mom that the dog feels to me, because I have big dogs, they just feel more like this person. So I think, you know, empty nest syndrome. My children are grown.
They're grown.
So now
mm-hmm.
I have these two mm-hmm. little kids, Sophie, Simon. So I just like sink my hands into them.
And those of you who have read Judy's book, Lucid Darkness, Simon is a main character in her book.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is. Ten reasons why cats are better than dogs. Let's have some fun with this. When cats treat your guests politely. When friends arrive at your home, dogs go into a frenzy, barking, leaping, pay attention to me. While dogs do everything possible for approval, from racing around the room to bouncing like a basketball, the cat is usually nowhere to be seen. They prefer to observe the new arrival from afar. She'll stay discreetly out of the way while the dog lusts for and sometimes runs away with the main course.
That's great.
Cats smell better than dogs.
Hmm. All that licking, right? That rough tongue.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Even the most dogged of canine devotes must cop this one. There's nothing quite like oud de fido. Cats, with their constant self-grooming, perform and regulate their body temperature as well as they're keeping clean. Number 8 of why cats are better than dogs. Cats are funnier than dogs, even if the cats don't know it. If you go on YouTube, they claim that there's more funny cat YouTubes than there are comical ones and dog ones. I don't know if that's true or not.
I don't know. I watch a lot of dog YouTube.
Yeah, I
suspect
pretty
funny. So. Yes.
Even the loudest cat is quieter than any dog. Most dogs will always vocalize their mood. A cat will keep to himself. Loudly, dogs announce every news event. It's rare that your cat's hissing is going to keep your neighbor awake. Cats are natural insect repellents. I know this to be true. They fly in my house. It's toast. Mm-hmm. Don't bug me. He means the cat. Cats are fascinated by winged things and crawled creatures, and they're masters of extermination. Mm. My mom's had a little tiny mouse in her house, and I said, well, we'll get a cat. She goes, well, the problem is I have to keep the cat hungry to chase the mouse.
Yeah,
I said, well,
that'd
be kind of tough.
And then those little crunch, crunch sounds, I'll never forget when I owned cats. There were all these, crunch, 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 and I knew that there was a difference between the kibble crunch and that other kind of crunch. Oh, no.
How delicious.
Yeah.
Ever seen a dog's playthings? Shredded, rawhide bones, torn tennis balls. Cats tend to be hugged and carried and carefully hidden in beds and blankets. They keep their prizes safe from intruders. They're cat collectibles, so they're better fashion. Cats don't need to be walked. It's cold, it's midnight, and the dog doesn't care. It wants to go out for a walk. You know, demands a walk.
This is sounding better and better. Should I break the news to Sophie and Simon?
Yes, a quick trip to litter box.
Getting a cat.
The quick trip to litter box, and the cat is set all night. Mm-hmm. Even on a sunny day, cats won't dream of asking for a walk. Wear a leash.
So in our society, being that we are not as much at home for the most part.
Right, and again,
everyone.
That's one of the reasons why a lot of people who work and have, mm-hmm. Long-term jobs and maybe even gone on weekends and whatnot, if they want an animal, they're going to get fish or a cat.
And I know that there are a lot of people who do research into their best matched pet. So even within the canine species, there are certain types of dogs that are right for an owner and certain types of dogs that are not.
It turns out that in many instances...
Certain people should choose cats over dogs because they're not going to be able to walk that dog, mm-mm. and provide that dog with the social stimulation that dogs need.
It turned out in England they did a study with the dogs looking like their owners. And then 67% of the time they could actually match the dog to the owner. Mm-hmm. And it turned out the owners didn't look like the dog. The owners picked dogs that looked like themselves.
That makes total sense.
It was such a crack
up
when I read that.
The narcissistic
yeah, it was just
need
a crack
to,
up.
Have a mini-me, right?
Mini-me.
What about cats? Are owners picking cats that look like them too? Any articles on that? Just curious.
No, they
cat
talk
owners
more about
who,
dogs.
Who have red hair tending to pick red-haired cats.
Well,
it's
those tabby
like
cats.
Yeah, exactly.
No. So getting back to dogs, 10 reasons why cats are better than dogs. Cats don't even walk. Cats enjoy bringing gifts to their loved ones. This is what I was alluding to. A gift offered by a cat, whether it be a mole or a bird or a critter, is the highest tribute it can play and proof of devotion to you. It says basically, hey, I've been looking all over for this and I want it to be yours.
Well, it's not like they can go to Tiffany's or, right?
No, they can't.
And gift wrap their gifts. So they give what they give. They can give.
That's it. Okay. And then cats and laser pointers are entertainment all the time.
Although I have to tell you, my dogs bring me gifts all the time. When I come home, they will find their favorite toy, and that toy is in their mouth, and they're presenting that toy to me. It's just it's
good
really,
for
really,
you.
Really. It is good for me. It is good for me.
Good for you. And number one of why cats are better than dogs, as I've mentioned, they purr when they're hungry or they're happy. Mm. A cat's purr, its thrumming rhythm alerts helpless kittens, humans, that their feline friend is oh so content with life. Who needs words when a purr says it all?
Mm-hmm. So let me ask you, pop quiz, Walt. So why do you think animals have this great capacity over humans? How come we're not learning enough from them? How come we're not accessing the very most wonderful gift they have to offer us, which is unconditional love and acceptance, and learning how wonderful that is for our mind, body, soul, and capitalizing on what Walt and I know to be, and many people know to be, the most powerful healing force on the planet, which is the
unconditional love.
And animals seem to tap into this so totally and so naturally, and yet we're so smart, and we're not learning the basics of the most important element necessary for survival of our species, because the most challenging disconnect of all is not hate, but do you know what it is?
It's apathy. Yeah.
Right.
It's apathy.
Apathy is the basis for sociopathy, because if somebody has no remorse, they have no feeling for another human being, then they can create a lot of pain and suffering and repeat over and over again. Serial killers, so on. No apathy, no ability to love. Whereas an animal may kill in defense of a loved one, or may kill because they need the food supply, but there's more of a fight or flight syndrome involved. And so we as human beings, we're just much more neurotic about keeping our defenses within and not being able to take a fight or flight stance. So therefore, we go sideways into the symptoms, whereas animals are much more clean. You know, if an animal is tense, they will stretch.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if we're tense, right now, what am I going to do? I'm sitting in this chair. I want to actually stand up and touch my toes, but I'm not going to. I'm going to sit here in this chair.
The show must
go on.
Because
I really do want to.
The show must go on.
Actually, but if I was a dog or cat, mm-hmm. I'd be out of my chair right now, and I'd be stretching and doing up dog, down dog, whatever, up cat, down cat.
Well, that's what
and
kids do.
It would be very, very comfortable and natural. So I think that one of the healthy aspects of animals is that they do what they want to do when they want to do it, and it's usually right for them, mind, body, and soul. Mm-hmm. And so that's why they stay so healthy.
You're listening to Dr. Judy WTF here on the UBN Network, Universal Broadcasting Network, and you can pull us on iTunes or Stitcher, or listen to us also on TuneIn on your smartphone. And I'm Walt Lusk. I am still my daughter's dad, and you can find us on. Yeah, I still am. And they still take my phone calls. I know, I still am. And they can still find us at www.drjudywtf.com. And we are talking today about cats and dogs and animals and their owners.
And then there are certain animals that have higher levels of empathy and better ability to mother than other animals. And
they're
very, very
amazing. You're talking about empathy.
Amazing.
I thought this was an interesting article. I think you found this one. And this was something you guys can maybe talk about on the water cooler tomorrow. Mm. Elephants remember. Elephants have amazing capacity for emotion. They're the largest animal that on Earth, obviously. Mm-hmm. And they have the way to express joy, love, grief, rage, stress, and compassion. It's really amazing. And people have studied these, primarily in Africa. You know, the thing is, there's amazing joy and no shame in showing it. And the birth of a baby elephant is just the greatest celebration around. In addition to when elephants have a reunion. You know, when they finally make contact from a reunion, they form a loud rumbling mass of flopping their ears, clucking tusks, and intertwined their trunks.
And what do we do when we finally meet up with a friend? We say to the friend, hold on a minute, a cell phone call is coming in. Whoa there. Okay, so where are we in the chain of unconditional love and in appreciation of our fellow man? It's just so beautiful to know that the animal kingdom has a plethora of
absolutely
of wisdom to teach us,
and then
only we would listen
with love. Mother with her calf, an elephant, often touches her child, helps it to its feet. She bathes it. There's a strong, strong bond between the mother and the daughter, specifically with elephants, that lasts over 50 years because, you know, they live pretty long.
And isn't it so that when they lose a baby, they
yes.
grieve?
Oh, man. And this is, yes,
yeah,
indeed. Here's the grief one. This is amazing.
Amazing, yes.
The most moving displays of emotion is the grieving process. Elephants remember and mourn loved ones even years after their death. And if an elephant walks past a place that a loved one has died, he or she will stop, take a silent pause that can last several minutes. Then while standing over the standing over the remains, the elephant may touch the bones of the dead elephant, not the bones of any other species, smelling them, touching them, turning them over, crushing the bones. They're actually grieving and probably reliving memories.
And that reminds me of my relationship to my buried parents. And I don't go out there very often, but when I do go out there, it's like that. I want to touch the grave. Mm-hmm. I want to connect to the grave. Mm-hmm. I want to put rocks on mm-hmm. the grave that symbolize the connection and the respect. We want to bring flowers to the grave.
Right.
So the similarity between the memory of the elephant and the memory of the human being is quite remarkable.
Also, elephants express rage and stress. Terror, rage, and stress, unfortunately, are commonplace in the elephant repertoire. They actually display a type of post-traumatic stress disorder.
Especially in the way we're treating them.
Yeah, and we're disrupting their environment, which
Absolutely.
Is obviously causing a lot of rage and stress. And then lastly, compassion. One perplexing report of an adult elephant making repeated attempts to help a baby rhinoceros. This was a compassionate for not even its own species that was alive, stuck in the mud. She continued to try to save the baby rhino despite the fact that its mother charged her each time, risking her life for the sake of an animal that is not her own or not related to her or even his own species is remarkably altruistic in nature. The depth of elephant's emotion capacity knows no limit.
You know, I saw something on AOL the other day about a dog that was run over.
Yes.
And another dog.
You showed it, you sent me that.
To that dog.
Yes.
I don't know if the dog was dead or alive. It looked dead to me.
Yeah, it did.
And then the other dog went over to that dog and laid down next to the dog as though the dog was protecting this other.
And we've seen scenes.
Dog.
We've seen scenes, for example, with veterans that have passed, mm-hmm. and the dog somehow gets into the ceremony and will not leave that casket because that dog knows full well that you know his best friend is in that casket.
You don't hear that about cats, do you?
No.
Do you have any stories about cats that rescue their owners or cats
I've even got stories
stick around after the owner's dead or alert their neighbors that the owner's in trouble.
Dogs will even save humans and try and keep them warm, little babies, and try and do they can to maybe feed them if they're nursing their puppies.
Mm-hmm.
Dogs really, in some respects, are man's best friend. You know, this is a call-in show, folks. And, you know, even though we've got crickets going, it's mighty quiet in here. We want to see if you can still call us.
Wow, it's so quiet in here. I can hear crickets. Can you?
The number is 323-284-7826. And remember, I love a dog. He does nothing for political reasons. That actually was Will Rogers. I love a dog. He does nothing for political reasons. A dog is the only thing on earth that loves you more than you love yourself.
And in some cases, that's not too hard to do. I work with people who have some pretty negative core beliefs. And one of the things that I talk about in my course of treatment is that we have many levels of disconnect. For those of you who are spiritual, if you look at the trickle-down effect here, the first disconnect is from being in spirit to being in body. So we disconnect from source energy to enter the body. And then the next disconnect is we disconnect physically from our birth mothers.
Yes.
And sometimes our birth mothers disconnect emotionally from us. And then that creates a blueprint of us disconnecting from ourselves, disconnecting from our loved ones, disconnecting from our community, disconnecting from other species, and disconnecting from the world at large and trashing our planet, trashing our animals. That's a whole nother subject, the way we treat our animals. I stopped eating meat about 2 years ago. I started again with some guilt involved. What influenced me to do that was seeing the movie
Soylent Green. No, I'm just kidding.
Earthlings. Yeah, if you want to stop eating meat and you want to stop eating meat, Google the movie The Earthlings, and it's just a horrific example of animal holocaust. And what it brings to mind is that we are so sick as a society that there's so little empathy left that the people who are, many people in the animal industry, are not just killing animals for the meat, but they're killing animals brutally. And it's as though, in seeing this movie, it was as though I was watching a bunch of sociopaths having at it with the animals. So that's a whole nother show.
That's another show. I'm just going to add that one of my daughters is a vegetarian, and the whole reason is she doesn't want to eat anything with a face. Mm-hmm. I mean, just she doesn't want to hurt animals, and she's got an amazing, amazing soft heart, and you know, she'll eat eggs and cheese and stuff like that, but she just won't do anything with an animal that has a face. Mm-hmm. I thought before we get to our shrink that tune, I thought I would talk a little bit about the love of a dog helps us find balance in life. Mm-hmm. You know, how important it is to keep body, mind, and spirit in balance, but remember how unbalanced we have become as a society, which you just elaborated on. The love of a dog is unconditional. Being unconditional, that's a dog. Humans are very conditional. Dogs are accepting. You look horrible, but the dog will look at you like you're the most beautiful human being ever, because what he's looking at is your feelings, and dogs have integrity. But many humans measure integrity mentality with money, and that's how disconnected and unbalanced we have become, right? Mm-hmm. We connect, reconnect ourselves back to Mother Nature by basically, you know, having a dog, specifically in this example, and having it love you unconditionally.
Right. And then our ability to give back to that animal trains us.
Yes, it does.
Trains our muscle of unconditional love.
Yes. Their dogs are also
that heart chakra open.
Mm-hmm.
For all creatures.
It's tough to do, but I think you know, if you've got the constant companion of that dog staring you in the face, it's hard not to ignore it. Feed me. Dogs are loyal. I mean, they are pack animals, so they want to belong to a pack, whether they're made up of dogs or humans. Dogs are also naturally affectionate. The instinct is they want to bond. Dogs want to love and be loved. I think deep down, that's what we all want. We want to be part of a pack, contribute to their pack, and protect their fellow pack members. Okay. And lastly, the friendship between a man and dog has gone back thousands and thousands of years and really is man's best friend. So I think we're probably going to have to continue this series. Next week, we'll talk a little bit more about it.
I love the subject.
Yeah, this is great stuff.
I want to go deeper into what we can learn from them as parents, because absolutely the cure for psychopathology, from my perspective, is to have strong bonding take place between mother and infant, and strong family bonding between husband, wife, or your mate, so that you form the basis for security for the children that you're bringing into that family. And for all members, especially for all members of the human race, to take responsibility for healing their own psychopathology, which includes healing the mother-infant disconnects and the wounds and the feelings associated with it. And so, yes, I want to delve deeper into this and what we can learn even more from our animals. And just one other animal I wanted to bring up is the dolphin. And the other day I saw a movie of a dolphin who was caught in the big fish hook through its fin and actually went up to a diver and requested help to unravel this these wires and unhook the hook. It was just such a beautiful relationship because the dolphin entrusted
yes.
a human being to unravel,
to help
take
him.
Out the hook when it was indeed a human being who hooked him in the first place. So just this beautiful dance between animals and mankind. It's very, very pretty for me to watch and study.
It's beautiful.
Yes, it is.
It's beautiful. So it's come the time of our show, folks, where we shrink that tune. And today I've gone to the dogs. The
yes.
title of the song is The Dog Song. And it's by Nellie McKay. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to read the lyrics. And then Dr. Judy's going to interpret the lyrics. And then, of course, we're going to play the song. So this is The Dog Song. I'm just walking my dog, singing my song, strolling along. Yeah, it's just me and my dog catching some sun. We can't go wrong.
So this is just the sheer joy. You know, a lot of us have lost the ability to just play. And with the dog, they're just a natural at it. So just this freedom, the singing, the strolling, just me and my dog, this own little private world
yeah.
of unconditional.
And without a care in the world. Mm-hmm. My life was lonely and blue. Yeah, I was sad as a sailor. I was angry. Too. Then there was you. Then there was you appeared when I was entangled with youth and fear and nerves. Jingle jangle. Vermouth and beer were getting me mangled up. They were getting me mangled up.
Okay, so here we have the solution to the hole in the soul. Solution number one, alcohol, vermouth mm-hmm. and beer.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked in a previous episode about the need for dopamine and the need for the love bond drug,
yes.
which is the dopamine and the serotonin, so that when we don't get the correct unconditional love from our family of origin, particularly mother, father, then we will fill in that hole in the soul with substances. And so she's saying, look, I was lonely, sad, angry, you know, it's like the old AA, angry, lonely, sad, tired, whatever, hungry. And so she first turned to the vermouth and beer, and that was getting her mangled. And then there was you. There was you.
But then I looked into your eyes, and I was no more a failure. You look so wacky and wise. And I said, Lord, I'm happy because I'm just a walking my dog, singing my song and strolling along.
And I love the line about, I looked into your eyes because we look into the eyes of our caregiver to self-define and create our core belief. And so when we look into the eyes of a dog, there is no negativity. There's no Mm-mm. judgment there. There's no criticism there. So it's just pure unconditional love and acceptance staring back, which is the healing power.
And it's just me and my dog catching some sun. We can't go wrong because I don't care about your hating and your doubt. And I don't care what the politicians spout. If you want a companion, well, just go right to the pound and find yourself a hound and make that doggy proud because that's what it's all about.
Yep. So the reference to the human beings that have the hating and the doubt and the politicians that judge and criticize and put each other down. And so the dog, who is just such a simple creature, you could just go to the pound and pick up a dog, a bundle of unconditional love, and who will be saved? Well, maybe both of you.
Yeah, very much so.
Maybe both of you.
My life was tragic and sad. Yeah, I was archetypical loser, and I was poignant, gone bad. Then there was you on time and wagging your tail in the cutest mime, and you was in jail.
Well, who was in jail? Was it the person trapped in their own world of stress and their own world of self-doubt and shame and blame? And so now they look into the eyes of the dog and they're no longer losers. They're no longer bad because the dog is not seeing them that way. Well, how refreshing is that?
Mm-hmm, absolutely. I said, woof, be mine, and you gave me a whale, and then I was no longer alone, and I was no more a boozer. We'll make the happiest home. And I said, Lord, I'm happy, because I'm just walking my dog, singing my song, strolling along. It's just me and my dog, catching some sun.
And there is the dog as acting as a better than Prozac, better than booze, better than self-medication,
absolutely,
better than any other outside source of drug, because it still creates the dopamine and the serotonin and all that joy. It's a biochemical reaction.
It is. And again, we're just finishing up here on our Shrink That Tune. We can't go wrong, because I don't care about you hating and your doubt, and I don't care what the politicians spout. If you need a companion, well, just go right out to the pound and find yourself a hound and make that doggy proud, because that's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. It's about a wow, 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 about. That's what it's all about. Woof, woof.
Dedicated to the animal kingdom and their specialty at healing human disconnect with the most powerful force and underutilized force on the planet, unconditional love.
Unconditional love. Yes. You've been listening to Dr. Judy WTF here on the UBN Network. Again, you can pull us on iTunes or Stitcher, and you can even email us at info@drjudywtf. I'm your host, Walt Lusk, and Dr. Judy Rosenberg, and we tune in next week at 8 o'clock live here on the UBN Network, and that pretty much is our show, except for playing our tune. So with that, we bid you all adieu. God bless everyone. Thanks for listening. Nowhere to go.
I'm just a walking my dog, singing my song, strolling along. It's just me and my dog. We can't go wrong. My love was lonely and blue. Yeah, I was sad as a sailor. I was an angry one too. Then there was you appeared when I was entangled with youth and fear. And nerves jingle jangle, vermouth and beer were getting me mangled up. But then I looked in your eyes, and I was no more a failure. You looked so wacky and wise, and I said, Lord, I'm happy, cause I'm just a walking my dog, singing my song, strolling along. Oh, it's just me and my dog, catching some sun. We can't go wrong. And I don't care about your hating and your doubt, the politicians found. If you need a companion, why just go out by the pound and find yourself a hound and make that dog get proud, cause that's what it's all about. My love was tragic and sad. I was the archetypal loser. I was a pageant gone bad. There was you on time and wagging your tail in the cutest mime, and you was in jail. I said, woof, be mine, and you gave a wail, and then I was no longer alone, and I was no more a boozer. We'll make the happiest home. And I said, Lord, I'm happy, cause I'm just walking my dog, singing my song, strolling. Politicians spout. If you need a companion, why just go out by the pound and find yourself a hound.